Okay. Well, thank you, Anthony, and thank you all for coming out tonight. This is a little different than my usual mystery crime fiction audience. So whenever I get a chance to have this kind of perspective on it, other than crime, we could talk about the sociology or the history or the different things that go into this. You know, so I'm happy to be here to get that chance. But before I start reading, I want to just mention a few things about my first book, Chinatown Beat. And this book was published in 2006 after a big, long story. It stayed in the closet for a long time. But Chinatown Beat introduced Chinese-American NYPD detective Jack Yu, who in this book has just returned to Chinatown, his hometown, because his father is dying. And for any other reason, he'd rather not be in Chinatown because he's got a lot of history there, a lot of it not good. And he knows that all manner of Chinatown crime is going to come his way. And this from a neighborhood that doesn't trust and doesn't like cops. So he'd rather not be there. But where Chinatown Beat begins, his father has already passed away. So now he's got to clean out the old man's tenement apartment, the same tenement apartment that he grew up in as a Chinatown kid. So I'm going to read from that first, and I like to read from both of these books. I'll keep it brief as I can, and then we can talk about some of the other things, do a little Q&A afterwards. So I'm going to read from Dogs. The rain came down in thick sheets, rattled the stairwell windows as Jack climbed with leaden legs the five flights of tenement squalor. Pa had lived here all his 49 years of Chinatown life, a dead dog, the Chinese numbers meant, 49, say Gao. Time and again, Jack had asked Pa to move uptown, crosstown, Queens maybe, a decent apartment they could rent somewhere, where the winter freeze didn't sneak in through the windows, where the dank misery of changing seasons didn't settle on the bed covers, where vermin didn't feast on the kitchen table, in the toilet, under the pillow. Pa wouldn't hear of it, got angry each time Jack brought it up. Where would he get his Chinese vegetables, his Chinese newspapers? Where would he find his cronies to gossip with, to keep track of who died, who lost at the track? All the important things. Didn't matter, Jack would say. There were three Chinatowns now, Sunset Park or Flushing. Flushing too far, would be Pa's answer. And Brooklyn, too many Hokkien, blacks. New frontiers were opening up for old timers stuck too long, and for the newcomers too long locked out. No longer was the Chinese community defined by a single geographic boundary, but by a single consciousness of race. Not that any of that had mattered to Jack. He knew who he was, but knew he needed another space to live in, to be free from the burden his past here placed on him. But they trapped themselves, the old bachelors, wrapping themselves in their fierce Chineseness, taking pride in their disdain for American ways. Jack's ways. The man accusing the boy of trying to be white. Father and son were at cross-cultural odds, their lives a clash. The keys were old and tarnished, the metal edges worn smooth and rounded from 100,000 turns. The lock itself was older than the keys, older than the grime in the hallway. Jack twisted the key and heard the bolt open silently, effortlessly. He pushed open the creaking door and stepped inside Pa's world, his own past. Nothing had changed. He wondered why he'd even thought it might have. Under the dim, lifeless circle of fluorescent light spreading along the flaking gray ceiling, everything looked the same. He stared at the scuffed and dented linoleum floor, produced the slim silver flask he prepared for the visit to the cemetery, full of the whiskey with which they'd celebrated life and mourned death, sanctified liquor. He took a deep swallow, swinging his black knapsack down to the floor. There was the tear-off war calendar from the Hang Sang Bank, bright red with raised gold Chinese characters, trumpeting the year of the dog, the thin sheet of white paper printed with the number 4 in black, freezing the day Pa died. September 4th, 1994, Gao Se, Gao Se, twice a dead dog. He crossed the stillness of the room to Pa's bed, pulled plastic packets of photographs from the bedside table, saw they were thick with dust, except for spots where fingerprints had touched down recently, pushing across clear lines in search of memories. How soon near the end do we begin to grope for our past? When he opened the albums, the fingerprints led him to streaked and faded black and white photographs of himself as a child, then pictures of Ma, sometime in the 1940s. Her hair was shiny and combed back, away from eyebrows, perfectly curved and sharp as a razor. Her mouth slightly opened and dark lips smiling, revealing teeth framed in gold. She couldn't have been more than 19, an arranged bride. Her almond eyes, small lights of hope, resignation. And there was the picture of himself with Pa, taken on a visit to the Tofu King almost a decade ago, by the front counter with the bean curd tofu and the flat sheets of white noodles. He swallowed quickly, noticed Pa's gourd-shaped bottle of Maotai liquor on the floor. The seal had been broken, but it felt more than half full. His mind drifted backward. Jack was never the good son, but he struggled to maintain the truncated sense of family he had with Pa, who, in the few hours he was home from the laundry or the restaurant, was full of criticism or complaint, the smell of whiskey tinging his words. Other times around holidays, Pa was more melancholy, but managed to smile and brought home sweet cakes and fruit for his son, the Chuk Singh, the American-born, the empty piece of bamboo. Jack flipped the cellophane-covered pages, came across old prints of Pa in the laundry with Grandpa, who had gone back to China, beside him. He took another swallow. Then, sliding his fingers through the dust-covered pages, came to a curled print of himself in the pool room. In between Tat Louie and Wing Lee, all mugging for the camera. And now, sitting on his father's crumpled bed, Jack was unable to find the peace of mind he needed. What bothered him wasn't the neon lights from the Lee Luck restaurant sign whose colors intruded into the darkened room. It wasn't the clawing sound of rat feet scratching for entry somewhere along the baseboards near the radiators. And it wasn't the smells of lap cheung, pork sausage and ham yu, salted fish, long since leached into the walls, becoming one with the cracked and peeling green paint after 30 years, making time stand still. It was the sense of being here, too late, the son, the cop, after the fact. Somewhere down the stairs across the hall, he could hear the vague sing-song of Chinese opera, and closer, the rat-a-tat action of Hong Kong videotapes. He hadn't had the chance to say goodbye. Decades of Chinese smell and sound hung so thick he could almost touch them, settling upon him a strong feeling of his father's presence. It wasn't Jack sitting on the bed after all. It was his sense of his father, mixed with the spirit of his own younger self, surrounded by the ghosts of his father's bachelor apartment. Jack felt the thirst grabbing in his throat and emptied the flask. Pulling the few much-fingered pictures from the album, he slipped them inside his vest pocket and tossed the rest into the empty Seagram's carton on the floor. And as he lay down on Pa's pillow, memories came flooding back. Then the alcohol reached his brain and rolled him back a decade and 4 years into a nightmare. The three of them, Tat, Wing, and himself, racing across rooftops, leaping the spaces between buildings. Tat is throwing stones at windows as they run, three teenagers shrieking with juvenile laughter, curses following them from inside the tenement apartments. They are clambering down a fire escape, dropping to a courtyard below, and Wing is shouting, "Race! Last one sucks lap cham!" And they are sprinting through a back alley, jumping cinder block partitions, dashing for a connecting tunnel. The other end of the tunnel leads out to a side street, and they don't see the gang of Hua Yings until Wing crashes headlong into the leader. He cuffs Wing with a backhand punch, snatches a gold chain from his neck. Wing lunges for the chain, and the nasty boys break out their knives. They're flipping the chain from one to another, taunting Wing. Tad steps sideways, launches a sidekick into the leader's groin, and suddenly everybody's screaming, cursing. The Ying leader swings his switchblade around, and with a short punch, blunts Wing's desperate charge. Wing lurches back, then charges again, his eyes white now. There's a crash of black and white across Jack's forehead, blood from the gash running into his eye as he watches Wing dropped by a chopping right hand, the color of red wine suddenly spreading across Wing's white t-shirt. Tat is screaming, and the Yings are beating the shit out of him. Then everything is black, filled with the wails of a family overcome with grief. Racks of flowers fail to brighten a room cloaked in the choking odor of incense and death. Wing is laid out in the casket, and mourners are bowing, 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 and burning death money. Tat is speechless, and Jack watches him flee the funeral parlor as Wing's mother explodes with grief. The sound of gunfire awoke him, yelling and shooting in the connecting back alley that led out to Mott Street. In the dark of Pa's apartment, he could not tell what time it was, only that it was still black outside. More gunshots and screaming. He groped for his coat special, found it, and crept out onto the stairwell landing. From the hallway window, he could see shadows and figures darting through the alleyway. He slapped out the hallway bulb with the gun barrel, crouched to observe the action below. But in another instant, it was quiet again. When he climbed down the fire escape into the alleyway, they were all gone. Only a few spent shell casings on the ground and the burnt smell of gunpowder in the dark air. No bodies, and too dark to see if there had been bloodshed. He tried to shake the grogginess from his head, his adrenaline rush subsiding now, leaving a ferric taste in his mouth. Back in Pa's apartment, he sat upright on the bed and closed his eyes. Sleep didn't return, and he reached for the flask and tilted it, but it barely wet his lips now. He picked up the gourd, shook it, refilled the flask with Maotai. Then he found the keys to his fury and went back out into the deadness of night. Of course, there's a lot of other stuff that goes on in Chinatown Beat, which will explain why at the end of the book, Jackie was no longer in the Fifth Precinct. Which leads us to book two. In book two, Jack Yu is now in the Ninth Precinct, which covers part of the Lower East Side. It's an adjacent precinct to Chinatown, so he's not too far away, but he's out. And where Year of the Dog begins, Jack Yu has just finished an overnight shift, which is like a midnight to 8 a.m., but worse. There's a few more hours tacked on. And, you know, so he's exhausted. And where I'm going to begin, it's a freezing New York City morning down in Alphabet City, his new precinct, and it's Thanksgiving Day. And before he goes home, all he can think about is the hot clam chowder at the Korean deli down from the station house. So I'm going to read from Bodega Coreano. Kim's Produce was a mom-and-pop Korean deli on 10th Street, a few blocks from the 9th Precinct station house. It was 9:18 a.m. on the Code 45 display clock, well past his 12-hour tour, when Jack joined the cashier's line with his takeout container of hot clam chowder. A small television set showed the Thanksgiving Day parade. He sipped the steaming soup as he waited, watching the TV. Jack had mixed thoughts about the holiday seasons in the city. These were celebrations, but for many people, the seasons were very sad times. There were two cities here, one rich, one poor, each spiritually, if not physically, segregated from the other. Jack watched the Macy's parade march down Central Park West, past the stately and formidable buildings whose names rolled out: Majestic, Prasada, Dakota, San Remo, the landmarks of the rich and fabulous, private balconies with front row views. The majorettes fronting the marching bands moved briskly down through the 20th Precinct toward the old Mayflower Hotel, then on past Trump International, where top-shelf guests reserved mid-level suites for holiday packages at $1,000 a night so that their children would be thrilled by the giant cartoon balloons floating past their floor-to-ceiling double-pane glass windows. The Pink Panther, the Cat in the Hat, Barney the Dinosaur, Sonic the Hedgehog, who had an appetite for lampposts along Central Park. Down below at street level, 2 million of the hoi polloi gathered along the parade route, crowded and penned in along the sidewalks in the bitter cold. Tourists and middle-class families from the outer boroughs saw the floats rolling by, Big Bird and Santa Claus and comic book heroes floating in the sky. The parade moved south towards Times Square, passing through the Midtown commands, Manhattan North and Manhattan South. It would all end, Jack knew, at the Macy's store at Herald Square, where there would be backup from the 10th and 13th precincts. And of course, plenty of overtime uniforms managing the crowds, working the barricades and the subways. Much farther downtown, Jack knew, there were no luxurious hotel rooms, no balloons or floats. On the Lower East Side, Lower Saida, the holidays found citizens of the old nine at soup kitchens and food pantries at the Bowery Mission, where the hungry homeless families and the poor eagerly awaited a traditional hot turkey meal with all the trimmings, with the rest of the citizenry giving thanks, there but for the grace of God go I. Holy Cross, St. Mary's, St. Mark's Shelter, soup kitchens scattered throughout the precinct gave them all something to be thankful for, even for one day. The holidays were a humbling time for them. The displays of cheery celebration and religious and commercial spectacles were not theirs. To them, it was only another year of struggle passing by. In Chinatown, most people didn't celebrate a traditional Thanksgiving, but the holiday provided an excuse for them to get together and feast on a meal of seafood, pork, chicken, baby bok choy, lobster Cantonese instead of turkey, rice instead of mashed potatoes, with winter melon and lotus root soup. Extended families gathered around da bin lo, hot pot casserole style cooking. Jack didn't have fond memories of the holidays. Pa had never felt he had a lot to give thanks for and hadn't been a big believer in Christmas either, so Jack rarely received gifts. His one big thrill had been getting something from the 5th Precinct PAL, where he'd lined up with all the other deprived Chinatown kids hoping for a holiday handout. He remembered one year getting trampled in the mad rush of the older kids and parents to get a free toy, trampled for a Popeye the Sailor Man. He cried, but was still happy to have the free gift. When he brought it home, Pa had derided him for getting run over for a stupid Guelo doll. Jack reached the cashier at the same time that his cell phone jangled and broke his reverie. He paid for his soup and flipped open the phone. It was the day shift duty sergeant telling him patrol had responded to a call and found multiple bodies, very dead, at One Astor Plaza, down from the Barnes & Noble bookstore. Sergeant Donahoe was in the blue and white downstairs at the scene. Manhattan South was responding to holiday road rage, auto fatalities on the West Side Highway, so they were reaching out to Jack. On my way, Jack said, pocketing the phone. He finished the soup in a big swallow, turned up his collar, and emerged onto the frozen street. He made his way west through the East Village, the icy wind already tearing at his face, icy needles prickling his eyes every step of the way. Most of my characters in my stories are Chinatown people. Just ordinary Chinatown people with extraordinary stories. And one of those characters is a woman named Bo, and she works in one of the many Chinatown hair salons. She's a hairdresser. And what she's trying to do is to pay off the snakehead human traffickers who brought her here. And during this time, it was $40,000-$50,000. So that's a big monthly nut. What the snakeheads really want to do is that they want to turn her into a whore. But since she's able to make the monthly payments, she's keeping them at bay. So I'm going to read from Time and Space. Bo sat in the quiet solitude of her little rented room above Market Street, the silence broken only by the clicking of her bamboo needles. Seated at the foot edge of the single bed, her voice a whisper chanting, "Namor, namor, namor," prayers. She continued knitting this version of her rosary, a black scarf with the Chinese words for struggle, zhongjia, stitched across the top in white relief. In the black yarn were all the colors of bad luck. In the white yarn, absent color, the insidious tone of death. She was playing off the bad luck. Several inches below the Chinese character was a repeating pattern of horizontal S's, or white snakes. Two rows of them, totaling 25, now 26, with the one she was stitching in place. 26 snakes now. 26 payments to the snake heads. She paused and took a breath, let her eyes rove over the bowl of leftover jiksik, instant ramen on a tray, over the top of the used dresser, to the grainy photograph of three women, herself and mother, and small daughter in tow. Only the child was smiling. The little girl's mother and grandmother wore uncertainty on their faces and had small lights of hope and resignation in their eyes. Abruptly, Bo wrenched her attention back to the clicking needles, clicking faster now, left to right, an impatient rhythm. She hadn't seen them in more than a year, but they spoke every week, using the discount prepaid telephone calling cards that Saigo had gotten for her. Namor, 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 namor mei tofut. She focused on the needles, working the yarn, slip, stitch, purl, her fingers, hands, wrists, in active articulation. The same energy came from her hands when she'd cut Saigo's hair, massaged his shoulders. The black acrylic scarf was almost 2 feet long, knitted in monthly installments of white snakes. She prayed for strength to finish it, knowing it would take years before she'd be able to pay off the snake heads. Namor, 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 no more, slip, stitch, loop through, the ball of yarn twisting in the little plastic basket. Drop the white yarn, wrap the black, complete stitch. In the back of her mind, she remembered the myriad of forgotten jobs, and then the new Canton salon, and measured the price of freedom. And finally, Detective Yu gets involved with something that should have been a missing persons, but turns out to be much more tragic. So I'm going to read from Deliver Us from Evil. The falling flakes had made it all seem dreamlike. He tugged down his hoodie as he rode. The first delivery was easy, thought Hong. Practically around the corner from the takeout, a pretty blonde girl in a red sweater was waiting inside the street door of number 129 when he rode up. She came out, gave him $30, told him keep the change and Merry Christmas as he passed her the steaming plastic bag. He never even got off the bike. Looking east, he blew some snowflakes off his lips and put his head down into the wind, his teenage heart shining inside with thoughts of Christmas, full of love glowing like a neon sign in the night. It wasn't like the city was shut down, he thought. Messy was more like it. He rode the beat-up bike through the slush, through the ruts and furrows in the snow, plowed by people's feet stepping quick to get home for Christmas Eve. The ride was a slog, bumpy, but there were few people on the streets and he felt he was making good time, even with the flurries flying in his face. He glanced back at the bags of food, still secured on the rear carrier, then took a few quick deep breaths, exhaling bursts of steam. He dug his China-made knockoff Timberlands into the pedals, pushing and leaning forward, rolling toward the soft lights and shadows of the projects in the distance. As he rode, he felt the quiet anxiety that lurked in the back of his brain, concerned for his own safety. But at least the rickety bike was holding its own. He remembered past trips there when neighborhood kids accosted him as he pedaled away after a delivery, calling after him, Ching Chang, Chinky, 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 and yelling kung fu screams. But he also remembered the nice fat black lady who gave him a $5 tip after he delivered a large shopping bag of takeout for a party she was hosting. He could not remember which project's building that was, except that it numbered in the 400s. He calmed himself by remembering that in the holiday season, people tended to be more generous with their tips, especially on cold, snowy nights. He thought about meeting up with his high school friends later and gradually made the right turn onto the long, dim stretch of Avenue D into the forbidding shadows of the Jacob Riis projects. He passed several buildings, rolling beneath the naked branches of the tall trees 20 and 30 feet high, a skeletal canopy of limbs waving in the air above the lampposts, whipping shadows everywhere in the courtyard. He passed the raised platform of playground apparatus, realized that what he imagined were bodies huddled together were actually piles of black garbage bags someone had hoisted there. A few more quick breaths. On a hunch, he turned left into a smaller courtyard hemmed in by the high rises, straining his eyes in the dim light looking for the numbers on the buildings. Following the curving line of lampposts that brought him around to brighter yellow glare, he began to decipher the numbers. Great, he thought, having arrived at the first 400 building. He was proud that he'd come so close to the delivery address his first try. He chained the bike to the low iron railing that bordered the playground area, double-checking the address on the receipt. He undid the takeout from the rear carrier and went across to number 444. When he entered the lobby, he heard Christmas music playing somewhere, drifting down through the elevator shaft, carried along with the faint smell of urine and feces. He tapped the elevator button, measured his breathing, and considered having to make change for the customer. The elevator door opened with a sound of scraping metal. He instinctively peeped inside, making sure it was empty, before stepping in with the bags of food, knuckling the button for the 14th floor. The floor numbers lit up as he was carried aloft, floating on the Christmas music, thinking about the Chinese club party and how late he was going to be. And I'll leave it at that.
444, did you die?
Well, see, you get the sociology.
No, when I read your books, no, I have such pleasure to hear the Cantonese translation. There's only one book that completely Cantonese, but 444, this guy is going to have a lot of trouble.
I'm going to leave it at that.
I'll buy a book.
For all you didn't read book two, I'm going to leave it at that.
No, but did he die?
I can't tell you that. And we're being taped.
Say.
Hey la. You mean what you see, la? So this is fun. I mean, this audience, we get to talk about other things than police procedures. The way I write, the sociology that's in the stories. I'll be happy to take some questions, but when I first started writing in college, I wrote a few things for the school newspaper, and that's really where I started becoming interested in writing and finding my voice. They call your voice. And during those days, I wrote everything on small scraps of paper back in the neighborhood, because we'd come stumbling out of the gambling houses and the pool rooms at 3-4 in the morning, and you know, you just be in an altered state of consciousness, you know where that's going. And you know, there are not a lot of places, so you wind up on writing on coffee napkins from the all-night Chinatown coffee shops and little scraps of paper you can pick up from the street anywhere. And I'd throw all these scraps into a milk crate that I had at home, and every so often when I get a moment of clarity, I take it out and look at these things and say, well, you know, there's a story here and there's a story here, and then you would kind of blow it up and you'd have all these, start taping these little pieces of paper together, and you get this obtuse looking map and there was a story there. And so that's the way I worked then. The only thing I do different now is I have a pad and a pen, so I try to be as prepared as I can be. You know, so that's the way I wrote. and that's the way I still write today. I don't walk around a laptop, or, you know, and you know, you have to power up everywhere you go. And I write on the move all the time. You know, I'm in the rain. It's very organic for me. I'm in the freezing weather, the rain, the snow. Really doesn't matter, because that's where you get your stories. You see how people react in the different elements, at different times of the year, the things that they do. So I like to be out there with it. I'm not in a room behind my laptop trying to make this up. Most of it I didn't have to make up. Well, of course, the quasi-pornographic debauchery, that is just a lot of research, and you know, I get into trouble with that all the time. You know, people said, Henry, how do you write that stuff? I said, where'd you find that? I said, oh, I just research. It's just research, you know. So, it's nothing biographical with that kinky stuff. So that's the way I wrote then, and that's the way I wrote now. And there came a time when I was able to cobble those stories together, and that became this. So all the dark little stories, all the violent, angry, sexual stories that I took out of that milk crate, kind of found a way to cobble them together and became this. So that leaves all the other good, lighthearted, traditional family stories in there, which somehow has not seemed to find a market yet. And, you know, so what I try to do is make Chinatown a character. Chinatown itself is one of the characters. The neighborhood has a history and a sociology all its own. It's Chinatown looks different during Chinese New Year's than it does during the Mooncake Festival. It looks different than on Veterans Day when the old Chinese soldiers come down the street. It looks different during the different cultural celebrations and times of the year. The food they eat, different things they eat in the winter they wouldn't eat in the summer. So you take all these items of sociology, and somehow you try to work them into the story, you know, where it's important enough to work them in. And that's what I try to do. So, you know, every neighborhood, every environment that you try to create from has its own sociology, its own quirks, its own, the way that it behaves. And in this case, Chinatown, as a character, affects all the people, all the other characters in the story who are all in Chinatown. So if there's a celebration or if it's Chinese New Year's, these characters are in that scene. And it's the holiday, it's the history, it's the tradition that affects what they do in the story, how they react, and how they talk. So I think I'll continue to do that as long as the formula keeps working, as I try to finish the trilogy, which I'm trying to get done by June. So, Q&A, anybody?
How often do you write? Every day for how many hours?
Well, I took a leave from my job, so now I wake up, I have a pot of green tea, it gets quiet in the house, and I start. And I just go through the course of the day. And of course, there's all the other stuff of life. I mean, the laundry's got to get done. You got to, you know, like all the stuff that we normally have to do. But
so how many hours you can get in?
Oh, if I'm lucky, I get in 3 or 4 hours. You know.
And for that, how many words can you write?
I generally try not to think that way.
No, my lecturer won't let me say how many pages he said. Pages are not accurate, it has to be the words.
Absolutely right. I try to think more in terms of scenes. Mm-hmm. If I get this scene done today, it could be 5 pages, it could be 10. You look to have that little window of at least 2-3 hours. You know, and after which time you're a little tired in the head. Yes. You just need to step away from the thing and go out and get some air, or you know, in the afternoon the green tea becomes a cup of red wine, and then it's other stuff, you know. So if I can get 3 or 4 hours a day.
And you link the scenes together, I mean, your great scenes that come to your milk can or your bag or something now, and you just link them and make it coherent and to the point and make the big novel work. Is that the way you do it, or you create it now on the way, now that you are veteran?
I'm changing. I hope I'm getting better. The first book was really more like that. all the little stories and putting them together. Because before you're published, you think, will I ever get published, and will I just get the one shot? Because, you know, you write something, you write for people to read it, you don't know if they're going to like it, maybe they'll hate it. Maybe you think you only get the one shot. And this book was in the closet for 12 years because nobody liked it when it first came out. So you think you get the one shot and you say, well, let me give them everything. Let me get it all in there. You know, all the colors, the ingredients, the spices, let me throw it all in there. And of course it has to make sense somehow. So we have a police procedural. We have this skeleton of a police investigation. You know, the big mystery in my books is not whodunit. I mean, you can figure that out after like the first 12 pages. But it's really the mystery of what happens down there in that environment, how it happens, and why it happens. So the first book was like that. I threw everything I could in there. The gangs, the sex, the violence, everything. And then we got a lot of good buzz early on.
Because Cold Mountain doesn't have the challenge for the second book. You know that I mean, something so big, it's completely gone. This is pretty good. I hope your gang names are correct, because I'm using the same thing that this will. Because my book is not the gang book, it just happened to be one of the involvement of the students. Mm-hmm. And of course I hope you can talk about them. How to break into the market. I think that part is awful. Writing the book is fine.
Yeah.
It's fun.
Yeah.
Sometimes
you're talking about getting an agent and having the agent shop it around.
I thought
Betty Lee Song?
Lee Song, but it
my professor in college.
Yeah, but she's not the one that get you into them.
No. There's an interesting story how that happens. When I first wrote this book, it's maybe 12, 15 years ago. And my agent at that time took it around to all the big houses, publishing houses.
And
back then, her name was Deborah something. I don't even remember. But nobody liked it. She took it around to all the big houses. Nobody liked it. I think they couldn't figure out what it was. Maybe the climate was different back then.
Yes.
I don't know. They didn't see it as Asian American literature. They didn't see it as a mystery. You know, it's not like a tightly plotted mystery that you have to guess every little thing. So they didn't really, didn't think much of it. And I drew it in the closet and I continued writing the other stories in the milk crate. And I tried to write some screenplays or poetry, you know, any media necessary, you know. And so I kept doing that. What happened was, it stayed in the closet for a long time, and one day I got a security position downtown near Chinatown. So I thought, great, now I could just walk to work because I live in Chinatown. I walk there, I don't have no more commute. This is so cool, right? So one night I get off work and the guards are closing up and it's dark and so I decide, man, it's getting late and it's cold and I'm going to take the shortcut behind the courthouse and the prison. So I go behind there and I see a wheelchair coming my way. It's one of those motorized things, you know. And it's a narrow passageway, so I move over to one side just to get out of the way. And as the wheelchair gets closer, I think I know this person. And she's looking at me like she recognizes me. And as we get close enough, she says to me, oh my God, Henry, is that you? And it was my old friend Doris, who I hadn't seen in 15 years. And she had been an editor at Reader's Digest. So we caught up in those few awkward minutes and she said, you know, what are you doing? You know, why don't you send me some of your work? And I'm like, yeah, sure, okay, don't worry about it, send it, yeah. And I kind of blew it off and I never sent her anything. And 3 days later, because she had moved back down to the neighborhood, she called me and said, where's my stuff? You said you're sending me some stuff. And I said, okay. So I go in the closet, I take this manuscript of this book, and it was so dusty and dirty, I had to sponge it off. Put in a plastic bag, so I go over, I give it to her, and a few days later, she read right through it, you know, two or three days later, and she calls me, oh, absolutely loved it, and it's just what I, you know, and I'm thinking, well, you know, she's afflicted, you know, she can't walk, I mean, so, you know, she hadn't seen me 15 years, what's she going to tell me, your book sucks? So I said, okay, right? I thought she's being nice, right? I said, okay. She says, well, can I show it to some people? I said, yeah, show it to whoever you like. It's been in the closet 12 years. Go ahead, have fun. Go show anybody you like. So sure enough, a week later, I get a call from these two people say they love the book and this and that, and it's everything they were looking for. And I'm like, so it's a conspiracy now. They're trying to make me feel better, right? I said, what is this? I said, I've been there before, right? They say they want to represent me. They want to be my agents. I said, okay, well, I've been here before. So we signed a contract, they're my agents, they take the book around, and the first 6 months, nothing. Nothing. And I'm like, well, I've been here before, so this is no big deal. And then the seventh month, they said, you know, we got a bite, this publisher who's interested. I put on my suit and I go uptown and meet the guy, and the conversation goes swimmingly along, and it's like, yeah, we shake hands, and I go home. A week later, I get the call. Sorry, Mr. Chang, we loved your book, but we were only budgeted for two books, and yours was the third one. It was close, but, you know, we can't publish it. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you. So after 9 months, my new agents now call me and said, well, we sold the book. I said, well, yeah, I'm so happy. I said, who'd you sell it to? Soho Press. I'd never heard of Soho Press because I didn't come from the mystery crime genre. I was writing, you know, what I thought was Asian American literature. So,
weren't you published by
Echo? No, Soho Press. Yeah.
Oh, is this the imprint of any big house?
They're independent. They're not that really such a small press anymore. They have a big catalog.
But you have that kind of exposure to criticism. That's hard to get.
Yeah.
I've seen my teachers trying so hard. I mean, they publish many books, even at Random House, but lost after the first book.
They got a lot of great writers that I'm coming to learn now because I'm new.
Great writers and readers in New York.
I mean, I'm in there with people now who have 10, 15, 20 books out. And I get my measly two books, and you know, I know it's not a marathon. I'll never be able to catch these people.
One book is enough. I don't know what you're talking about.
That's what my friend said. He said, Henry, you...
Well,
I'm trying to do something never been done before. If you look at the history of Chinatown literature...
Love story. Something like
love
that.
Story. I don't think I'm a love story kind of guy.
Well,
if that's interesting
nobody
perspective.
Knows do you believe that what you really experience makes good writing?
Oh, absolutely.
I think so.
Absolutely.
I never write about Chinatown. Well, I was taught there. No, nothing there except to eat there.
Well, when you first think about writing and you take some writing courses, they always tell you, write what you know. Write what you know. Don't try to make things up. And, you know, there's a lot you can do with research these days. You can Google,
yeah.
You can Google the hell out of anything. But still write what you know. Because
it's different.
Then it's authentic. And so this is what I know. Trying to get to the good stuff, the sweetness of light stuff, is not finding a market. People seem to like this dark, noir, kind of mysterious crime thing. So, you know, the smart money would say, well, you just keep writing this character until, you know, I can't write him anymore, you know. But there are other stories that may not have anything to do with Detective Jack Yu. So I haven't even gotten to those stories yet. So I can't see past the trilogy. I mentioned before they were trying to get me to write the screenplay for the movie option that they purchased.
You already purchased.
I said, I can't write the screenplay. I'm trying to finish the third book. I mean, I said, now already not enough hours in the day to try to finish the third book. It's driving me now. How am I going to? So it's kind of a distraction, you know, all that. They write you a check and you get the money and then you see if they're going to make a movie out of it, you know.
That would be nice.
Right. So anyway, that was the story. If I hadn't run into this old friend, I hadn't seen her for 15 years and didn't know she had been afflicted. If I hadn't run into her, this thing would still be in the closet and we'd have no reason to be here tonight. And then I probably wouldn't have written this because it was the success of Chinatown Beat that they said, well, you know, the book's going great guns, and you know, so when we made the proposal for the second book, it was real easy. You know, it was like, okay, yeah, we're awaiting it. And I've been lucky because my publisher, my editor, they haven't really changed much of anything in these books. Yeah, I mean, usually you get the manuscript back and it's dripping red ink and it's like, change all of this, and I didn't have a lot of that. So, you know, having a really good relationship with my editor, who's also the boss lady of the of the company. And so I'm just looking forward to trying to finish the third book.
What happened to the lady that get away from the, and killed the guy?
Again, I don't want to give it away.
Is there a second book?
Again, I don't want to give it away, but
in the second book, you want people to buy the second book.
I'm gonna say that in the third book, I am dealing with her situation in the third book.
Oh, not in the second book.
I don't want to give it away, but
all right.
Yeah.
So, how did you do when you were talking before, it sounds like you know a lot about the precinct in Chinatown. How did you do the research? Did you like just befriend people or?
Well, the research, I lived through most of that. A lot of that I didn't have to make up, you know, hanging out in the gambling houses and, you know.
I mean, the police stayed out of those places, right? I mean, or?
Well, yeah. You know, they didn't have that many Chinese cops back then. And the ones that went down there, everybody knew that guy was a cop. So it was like, you know, it was just an odd, awkward situation. You know, and the rest of the people were gang kids. So every time we went down, we weren't gang kids per se, but you know, when we went down, it was always 4, 5, 6 people. And then you'd mix with the gang kids, some of whom we knew. And you know, the thing they used to tell us back in the days, well, don't go down there like, you know, like you're a player, you know, don't have a toothpick in your mouth and have that look on your face like, you know, because you're just a player. You know, these kids are real, you know, they will mess you up. So there's a way of doing that. But most of it was really from personal experience. And once again, except for the pornographic stuff.
Oh. What about Jack Hughes? Jack Hughes himself belongs to the police department, so you must have some, how do you get the knowledge of what he does every day?
Well, I knew a couple of detectives in the 5th Precinct, who we won't name. And I've also had other friends, non-Chinese cops, who retire from the job, who are my friends as well. So if I ever have a question about procedure and law enforcement, you know, that needs to be vetted, I just ask my friends, I say, when you were on the job, how did you do this? Or would it be correct to say he did this and he did this? When he got arrested, would it have been like this? Or would he have been at Rikers? You know, would he have been in Dannemora? Where would he have been? Would he have been in federal lockup? You know, so all these things. And I just met the forensic doctor here, and I haven't had much need to do that because, like I said, these days you can research, you can Google anything. If you need to figure out somebody died, how they died, you can figure out kind of, you know, how it works. You can watch CSI on TV.
No, not much time. But do they have a captain?
Yeah, Chinese captain now.
Now it's
the second one in the history of the second or third now. That's a big move.
Yeah.
Chinese captain, Chinese cops. It's so different from, you know, people have read this book and said, "Yo, Henry, I want to come down to your neighborhood and check out all these kind of places." It's not there anymore. This you know, it's gone.
After this, I will be quiet so other people
can No, not at all.
I mean, after this, China's rise up, you know, and I sense that instead of pitying the poor Chinese or something who can't get a wife over and have to go back home to get a wife pregnant, they will feel, oh, what if China is going to rule the world or some silly thing, you know? And would it have affected the present-day Chinatown?
Oh yeah, sure. I think it would affect it as much as the McCarthy stuff in the 50s, and the way they came down our neighborhood and just rounded people up, you know. And then during the during the Korean War, you were Chinese, you were suspect. And of course, we all know what they did to the Japanese during World War II, you know. So international politics, yes, will affect the neighborhood. Sure.
Always go either one way too far or something.
But right.
We do need writers. Look at the Holocaust. Everybody in the world knows about the Jewish suffer. How many people know the massacre of Nanking? But
Iris Chang, and it's unfortunate what happened to her.
How did he die? I mean,
she's tragic. Yeah. That's why we have to support our Asian American writers and actors. And you know, I had this. I was at the OCA, Organization Chinese Americans, annual convention in Washington this summer. And
I seldom involve them. I feel I learned all my trick of the trade, nuts and bolts from my school, Berkeley, and now a new school. And normally I go there to give me discipline to write, but I enjoy writing very much. It doesn't matter if it doesn't get published. Lies.
Well, at the convention, there were Chinese American filmmakers, Arthur Dong, a handful of other writers, actors, and the sentiment was that Chinese and the Chinese Americans don't really support their artists. They don't support, they don't buy their books, they don't go see their movies. The movies come on, they last 2 weeks, people don't come out and see them, people don't support them. Because, you know, our people as a culture, we pride education. We want our children to be doctors and lawyers and white collar and professionals, and we don't encourage them to be writers or actors or filmmakers or anything like that. And so the sentiment was that we really need to support our creative people. Because if you look at black entertainment, BET, there's a huge market for black entertainment, and they come out and support. That's why you have, you know, Eddie Murphy all these big stars. Because they come out and, they support their creative people. So I think we need more of that.
Yeah.
Yes?
Do you find, like, most of the, I guess, Asian American cultural is coming from West Coast? And you seem to be the only one right about the East Coast. And there's a difference, isn't there?
Me and Ed Lin.
Well, I mean, okay. Yeah, but still, like, the films, the writers in the 80s. They all came from San Francisco, Los Angeles.
Well, true that, true. They came and they brought that awareness movement to us. I mean, Basement Workshop started, it was because people from the West Coast came over and brought a lot of new ideas. Bob Takashi Yanagita.
He's
from New York?
But most of them now have wind up going west, because I mean, one of the theories, of course, is like there are six generation from San Francisco.
Yeah.
And
the mother load.
And East Coast has more like first generation, so we're all struggling to survive and become something. The basics.
Well, you know what? I wish there would more writers would write this stuff. And you know, I've been writing it, you know, and all along I've been saying, you know, I'm writing these stories that nobody else is writing. You know, I wish they would.
Right.
Well, tell these stories. I mean, these stories are, you know, you were around somewhere around in the day, and there are a number of people who still remember these stories, and people come up to me and say, I can't believe you put Grandpa's Bar into the book. I mean, you know, who, and it's gone. All these places are gone. You'd come down here looking for it, and you wouldn't find these places. You wouldn't see the knucklehead gang kids on the street. That's a good thing. But that's what gives this all this flavor, all this crime and all this. It's not there anymore. You're not going to see it. But I wish somebody would, somebody other than myself and Ed Lin would, write about these times and these stories, because these people are disappearing, places are gone, you know, and the stories are important.
Yeah, because there are stories about, I guess, post-black civil rights movement, and then the civil rights movement that, I guess, the Asians would have to have, be more visible.
Well, that happened in the 70s.
Social service.
Yellow Pearl and...
Right, that was very difficult to distribute a lot of these. I mean, we only printed about 3,000, I think, and just broke even.
You know, back in the day, you could count the Asian American writers on one hand. Mm-hmm. Now there are just so many of them, and writing all across the spectrum. And that's great. Just not a lot of them writing this, but there's...
The inner city, the inner urban.
I mean, they're covering every single thing else, you know, from acculturation, immigration, stories of divided families and going back and finding your roots. And then, of course, you know, Amy Tan and Maxine and all the legendary sisters.
Two are the great ones. There's American, which is not Chinese at all, but she is such a, I tell you what, she writes things, she make up that the Chinese woman has a language. I was furious. This woman completely fell on Chinese culture, which she doesn't know. I think we should write our own stuff. We don't let...
Well, here you go.
There we go. I mean, this Maxime in the meantime, she too. There is one here called Something Inc. Has a very good book. I don't know that
Amy?
Not Amy. She wrote about San Francisco, Chinatown too.
Faye.
Very Faye.
Faye Mianeng.
Yeah, why didn't he write again?
Great book. She wrote Bone.
Yes.
And won a lot of national awards for Bone, and this is 15 years ago or something. Great book. And then her second book just came out called Steer Toward Rock. Great book. Really tells a really honest story about the bachelor generation. Those old men who were here and had all the paper names how the paper names thing were. It's in all the bookstores. You can get it online. It's called Steer Toward Rock. Steer Toward Rock. And it's
very
great book.
Times,
and she read at the Asian American Writers Workshop, where I read to it. And she was a good reader.
I only come here because of you.
Oh, thank you so
much. I
never
go out very much. This is my fault, really. I write about Hong Kong, chiefly.
I still have friends in Hong Kong. I miss that place so much.
Oh, I was born and brought up there, and I constantly hate America. I mean, I don't even feel like writing it until I can't stand the education they gave in 226 at that time, the Rivera. Mm-hmm. So my colleagues say, put down. I did write in the Washington Post about the Hong Kong reversion, a huge article. And I wrote for San Francisco Chronicle for a whole series. And I published in Hong Kong in Chinese. But as I said, my first book is in my closet, I think, for over 15 years and under 20.
How many pages is it?
350. It's all about growing up in Hong Kong, a baby growing up in Hong Kong during Second World War. It's the cell. I have seen so many agents say they're on the borderline. I have enough agents. I don't need their money. I have that. I can come from Hong Kong. I have no business.
You want to get published.
But that I can't stand their attitude, you know. So I say, and right as of the last time, they want a prologue and an epilogue. One of, actually, look at my third act. I think it's too long. I wrote about 15 years Hong Kong. I have no competition with you.
It's okay. I don't feel threatened.
God! I mean, I hope I have no chance. I thought I have no chance if I write the same thing you write.
Well, no, you have to tell your story. I think that would be a fascinating story.
And they're so
growing up Hong Kong.
No, people are so everything they follow the general idea. They think that all colonial powers are bad. Hong Kong will not be today, and China will not be what it is, if not that we learn from the British.
They
are mean, they took over us. I'm not going to cry. I'm going to learn what you do and do better than you. That's how we bankrupt the British. Oh, even China didn't take it back. The British are hopeless in Hong Kong.
Well,
but then they teach that.
Right on.
God, I mean, I feel we have been put down so much. And you have the nerve to say that we are threatened. Is China a threat or something? There's a meeting there, but I'd rather go to my writing class.
Yeah.
I say, what are you talking about?
Sure.
I mean, these people who know nothing about our culture and how we give and how we're really the kindest people. Why do we want to conquer the world? I mean, don't care whether we lead the world or not. Leave us alone. I mean, they come and criticize our one child policy. You know how many people we have?
Yeah.
Did you see the Olympics outside?
Yeah.
If we have two children, we'll be all starved. Because
you see, there's a story right there. You need to tell that story.
Oh, yes.
I would like to get back to your books, please.
Yes. Yes.
You're sort of saying that some of the stuff is past now.
Yes.
And I wonder whether in your three books, whether Chinatown, so to speak, is evolving, or whether all three books in some sense are about something that's reflecting at least to some degree, the first 30 years of your life, I think, or whatever.
No, I think every successive book you will see that the neighborhood is evolving. Mm-hmm. And we talk about the new immigrant groups coming in, the latest of which are the Fukienese. And before that, I mean, the Toisanese were the first, and then Cantonese, and of course we've had the Malaysians and the Chuzhou and the different inter-ethnic Chinese groups. And every group that has come along has brought along significant change, positive change as well as bad. Every group has its own kind of crime. Every group has brought its own cuisine, its own little nuances in the culture. So I see that in my stories, these changes all the time. In each one of the books, I think you will see the neighborhood kind of morph as we go. And these three books, well, when I finish the third book, all three of them will cover only about 8 months in Jack Yu's life. So there's a lot of room to go after that if I just stay with him, or you could do a prequel and go back and, So it's only 8 months of his life. Mm-hmm. And, these are the dominant things that have happened. His father has passed away. He's gotten involved in all this crime, and this the controversial stuff happens to him, and now he's in a different precinct, but he still can't get away from Chinatown crime, even though he's no longer in Chinatown. Mm-hmm. It's just it's the crime, and it's the Chinese victims just begging for justice that tugs at his sense of duty and responsibility. So, he's not in the precinct, but his old homeboy and blood brothers are criminals now in the precinct, and his other friends and other dealings in the neighborhood that are not always good. And there's plenty of reasons for him no longer to be there. So yeah, I like to portray the community as continually evolving, not in leaps and bounds, because it is only 8 months of his life, and you don't have such radical changes in 8 months, but you can touch upon the sociology, because you can pick the time period and you can juxtapose different events globally as well as within the New York and within Chinatown, and you can get more microscopic with it, but you can pick events as sort of timeline things, and you can take events and juxtapose them any way you want. I mean, after all, it's fiction. Though I've had people come to me and say, I know, I remember that. That didn't happen in 94. That was so-and-so, and that wasn't his name. That was, wait a minute, relax, it's fiction. Relax, and Chinatown people are like that, they remember the stories, and they read that, and I know that's so-and-so, and that happened to so-and-so, and it's not. It's not, a lot of the characters are composites of people I knew, gangsters I knew, good people, bad people, and I changed the names and the faces to protect the innocent as well as the guilty. And I don't want to knock on my door at 3 a.m, Then pay me off. Wait, people call me, So I don't want that. We've been looking for somebody to translate into Chinese. And my publisher hasn't found a person yet, because it's not just a literal translation. You have to be a writer to get the nuances in there. So they haven't found that yet. But they've sold the Italian language rights. So next year this may be in Italian, but not in Chinese. So my big fun thing was, how are they going to take the Chinese curses that I translated from Chinese into English and put it into, what does that sound like in Italian? I can't wait to see it. So I'm having fun with that. But yes, we're looking to try to get it into other languages and get, ideally, yes. I would love to see, they say that the Spanish and the French love mysteries and they love the genre, So it'll be in Italian and in the Romance languages before it gets into, unless, of course, they've already knocked it off in China. I don't even know, because I can't read it that well. If you see anything that looks like Chinatown Beat and it sounds like this story, they hung jing all the way, because I wouldn't know.
So related to this, have you planned any sort of like book tour in Asia or like go to Hong Kong and some university? Because I remember taking classes there about Chinese American literature. So, and they're doing a lot of Asian American literature in sort of different English departments. So
if they invite me, I will come. Yeah, it's a lot of airfare. I just like, I've done some things on my own money. Like I've gone to the West Coast and it's people I haven't seen for 20 years. So I went and then the publisher hooked up 5 readings for me while I was there. So it was business and pleasure. So I'd like to do that. But I can't justify hopping on a plane to go. I'd love to go to China, Hong Kong now. But the publisher is not paying to send me there. They have sent me, you know, within the States, nowhere really far, Baltimore, Chicago, you know, they haven't, I'm maybe going to Houston in March, and so which is, you know, I think they really are appreciating the success of this now and really pushing the second book, so I'm really happy with it. We got a lot of good press, and I feel they're promoting it pretty well. Yeah, I couldn't be happier. Yeah, yeah, just I got a whole stack of reviews, just, you know, everything from Publishers Weekly, and of course the New York Times article was a real kick in the ass. Entertainment Weekly, I was almost on the Brian Lehrer show at WNYC and expected to be in WBAI in about a few weeks. Of course I'm here and I'm doing MOCA and Asian American Writers Workshop, so, you know, it's, I'm having a great time with it. As long as it's fun like this, I'll keep on doing it. Once it becomes work, then forget. Last Thursday I was at, was it, not MOCA.
That's MOCA, they have the biggest event.
That was last night, there's
another
event.
Last night.
I forget now, was, I've done 6, I'm getting punchy behind all this. Yes?
How many cups of coffee do you drink per book?
I know, I'm not a big coffee guy, but like a pot of green tea in the morning. I can drink a whole pot of green tea just in the morning. And you know, so you get all, it's not decaf, so you get kind of juiced up and you're like, oh, and then your mind gets tired after 2 or 3 hours or, you know, just trying to figure out how to make something work and fighting with the words on the paper, you know, so and after, by the time the afternoon comes around, you've had lunch, you need a glass of wine.
Is this, how old is Jack Yu?
27.
Oh God, you can still make him a James Bond.
And we've only done 8 months, so he's got a, if I try to...
Give him a love story or...
Well, that's the next question. People have been asking me, like, they say, well, you have a, you know, Lucky the Gang Boy in here, and he gets all the best. He gets the best sex, the drugs, the rock and roll. It's all Lucky, you know?
No,
the bad guys.
You don't get him to go smooth.
Well...
Nobody will watch it. Lucky,
he'll have his day. But people have been asking
for
me now...
Reasons.
Yeah.
Yeah?
People have asked... When is Jack going to get some romance? Because it's 2 books now and he hasn't had any kind of intimacy. No, and I'm saying, you know, the guy's father just died. He's still grieving. I mean, he's not out partying looking to pick up chicks.
What about, you know, I mean, the Chinese, when they become very wealthy and they come from Hong Kong, they live entirely a different life. And those parents watch their offspring, no matter what they say, but then somehow somebody in that class or something poke up with Jack and let him suffer a little bit, and finally, you know.
That's your story.
I
see that? You have something going there.
No, I already have one of the teachers falling in love with the Italian detective because lack of running any more of the detective thing. And people are tired of the school thing. After a while, you can't make it. You can't sell it, you know, that people read something.
I've had friends threatening that Jack doesn't get some sex by the 3rd book. They're not going to read any more of the series. So you see the pressure that I'm under?
You're so, such a nice guy. People even tell you, feed you with, they say that some of Shakespeare's work is completely from people around him.
If you mention me in the same word, as same sentence as Shakespeare, I'm very flattered. They've already been throwing me. Somebody called me the Chinese Dashiell Hammett. Somebody else like, wow, I'm getting such a kick out of this. Putting, you know, saying. Anybody know George Pelicanos? Anyway, putting my name in the same sentence with a lot of big name, really big name writers who won all the awards, and I'm just happy to go along for the ride. I mean, really? I can't even begin to, you know, imagine like all these top-notch, really successful authors and that.
Well, they never heard of them. What's his name?
10, 20 books.
What's the last name is
that? One was George Pelicanos, who is a very successful mystery and crime writer. And
he's never read crime books and mystery.
Yeah, he's very well respected. The other one is S.J. Roseanne, who writes a mystery series set in Chinatown.
Really?
With a Chinese woman, private eye, detective kind of thing. I didn't hear her either before I came to this. Before, you know, I was, like I said, it was all Asian American literature. Don Lee and, you know, Faye and Frank Chin and Amy and Maxine and everybody else.
Well, Maxine is completely different.
Yes. And a lot of controversy with that through the years.
Yeah.
Which I'm going to stay out of.
Yes.
Because I know what's good for me. I went to a reading of Amy Tan's, and 200 people, standing room only at Barnes & Noble. And she didn't even have to read. She just talked about herself and her writing techniques and all of this. Didn't even have to read. 200 people came out for her. So, you know, it's all good.
In New York?
In New York, Union Square.
I see.
So most I've ever had was like 70 people. And I'm very happy to have 70 people.
I don't want to say the rest.
I've had 4 people as well.
But you are coming out. And Amy has written her story, I think.
People have said. Not I.
I can't read his book anymore.
Somebody
give me as a gift to put it away. I like the Turk. Orphan, he won 2 years ago the Nobel Prize. Mm-hmm. He wrote The Snow and Orphan. Well, I mean, if I die and write a book like his, never publish, I'm happy.
Well, I'm happy already, I don't need to die yet. My friend said, you know, at the end of the first book when he came out, he said, Henry, if you don't write another word, that's okay. You already started a fire. Just let it burn. And then, of course, I wrote the second book. So now he says, all you have to do is stay alive. And I said, thanks a lot. pressure.
Anybody have a final question for Mr. Chang? If not, give him a round of applause.
Well, thank you for having me. It's been real. We need to do this again sometime.